Please consider becoming a patron of MythVision Podcast. You'll get early access to every video, including this amazing one. And you can ask me personal questions, private message me, anything you'd like. Professor Tabor, James the Just, James the Brother of the Lord. Mythicists say this is probably just a pillar, but not a biological brother. We can maybe address this. At the same time, though, I want to go further than that simple, typical argument I hear between mythicists and historicists. Did he exist or not? I want to go deeper into the things you've explored on this character, who this man was. Peter's got the keys to the kingdom, but James rules the church and he has to say subordinate? Yeah, yeah. Something's up. And I guess what really gets me in most of my audience, whether you're a mythicist watching this or a historicist, I love what you do. Because what we've been told by the authorities, I say the authorities by the authoritarian church, about what is true, has a big question mark. I'm highly suspect of the narrative that we have been given. Mm-hmm. Not to say it doesn't work for some people, but I think there's political reasons when you get in the second century why they do certain things the way they do them. Mm-hmm. So tell us who James is, what's his role, what did he do, and then maybe we touch on the epistle of James.
Yeah. Well, let me start with when you visit the Vatican, which I've done a few times, and you walk up the main steps into the center entrance, you have Paul on the right, Peter on the left, these colossal, amazing statues. And they were martyred in Rome, supposedly, whether, you know, possibly. Not sure about Peter, Paul, probably. And you have to ask, where's James? Because this is the headquarters of the Christian church. You got the Pope inside, and he's a successor of Peter, not James. So what happened to James? And then you flip open Galatians, which we've touched on a number of times, and we find that the pillars are James, Peter, and John, presumably John, the son of Zebedee. I've written a lot about James. It's in the Jesus dynasty. It's a major part of that. The title of the book, The Jesus Dynasty, is the idea that there's a caliphate. That's not just a Muslim term. A caliphate means that blood lineage is important for leadership. And so Sunni and Shia are one example of that. But also, how about the line of David? You know, in other words, you've got to be of the line of David. Or most of the royal houses of Europe, even though there's intermarriage and different ways to get it more complicated as time goes on. Mm-hmm. But anyway, so when Jesus dies, his brother is appointed. And most Christians just reading the New Testament don't really recognize that, or it doesn't strike them with the force that it probably should. And some would not even notice it. But who's in charge in Acts 15? And this is Acts. And Luke plays down the family like you wouldn't believe. First of all, in chapter 4, he doesn't even name the brothers, doesn't even say anything about the brothers. And also, all the way through, he plays down Mary. I've written a book on Mary. It's called The Lost Mary. Probably because of COVID, all the books are back up now. Unfortunately, it probably won't come out until 2023 spring. So, you know, it's going to be a little bit of a wait. But it's because they stopped like 50 books for publication because of politics and all this stuff going on with Trump and so forth. But anyway, but in there, I really cover it pretty thoroughly. But Mark has, you know, Mark again, Mark 6, verse 3. Jesus is the son of Mary. And when, you know, that's another subject, like who's the father, but son of Mary, James, Joseph, Simon, and Judah as brothers. Matthew has that as well. So these brothers are here and they're mentioned. So Luke knows they're there, but who's this guy that stands up and says, my decision is? I mean, that's huge. And Paul has to go see him to kind of get clearance on things. So we get more outside the New Testament, but Paul does say, he names him first. He said, I didn't see all the apostles, but I saw James, the Lord's brother. Okay. I think they're biological. They're Mary's kids. It's the most obvious interpretation. I think most scholars think that. But because of sexuality and Mary needing to be a perpetual virgin, which is very non-Jewish, by the way, have a baby and then never get married, never have sex again and have kids, violates the first commandment of the Torah, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. So the Western Church says they're cousins. They're Joseph's brothers, Clophis's kids. And the Eastern Church says they're Joseph's kids from a previous marriage. He's a widower. So they'd be like half-brothers, you know, but not really even half-brothers because Joseph's not Jesus' father. So they're just like household brothers. It's even, I guess, is that stepbrothers? Yeah, I guess that would be stepbrothers. Anyway, so, but if we look at other sources, you begin to see that the idea of biological, I think, is pretty strong. You can read the book and judge it yourself. But I think he's very important. Now, we get things like the Gospel of Thomas. The disciples ask, whenever you leave us, who do we go to? Go to James the Just, for whom heaven and earth have come to be. Now, that's a Jewish expression. It refers to a group called the Lamed Vavnik. They're the 36 righteous, because 36 is one more than, like 70 divides in half, and then you have one plus, so it's the majority of the Sanhedrin. So there develops within mystical Judaism this idea that as long as there's 36 righteous people on earth, God won't destroy the world, because that's enough. So for whom heaven and earth came to be is a way of saying that he's one of the pillars, not just of the church, but of the world. He's very righteous.
Keeps the world from being destroyed
because it's back to Abraham. Like, what if there were 10? Would you? Oh, no, if there were 10 and they couldn't even find 10. And it's also in Malachi, lest I come and strike the earth with a curse. And the word curse is kerem, utter destruction. Malachi, it's the last verse of the Hebrew Bible, in the prophets at least, not of the Hebrew Bible, which ends in Chronicles. But anyway, so I think he's a brother. Jesus grew up with him. We don't know a lot about him. Did he believe in Jesus at first? Did he come later? He does get an appearance, which is very important, but we only know it from Paul. Notice, Gospels hardly even mentioned. Luke, not at all, really, in the Gospels. And then, yet we get Paul. He appeared to Peter, the apostles, and so forth. He appeared to James. So he gets an appearance. Maybe that's when he decided, you know, my brother is the one. But anyway, then we get lots of later sources, Clement of Alexandria, Clement of Rome, Irenaeus. They all talk about, and the leadership was given over to James. It's pretty uniform. I give all the best book, the best, Eisenman's is the thickest, most thorough study. I want to give him credit for pioneering Jamesian studies. But the best book for people that just want to get an overview would probably be Painter, John Painter, with the brilliant title, Just James, meaning it's just done, James. And it's a wonderful book. And he takes a lot of Eisenman stuff and other material and presents it. But those are the two books I would recommend on James. And then there's other books. Neusner edited a book on James. James has become big now, you know. I remember when I started this stuff 25, 30 years ago, it's like, people, James who?
Right.
And James has actually got into the public now because of the ossuary.
This is a question about James I'd like to ask you. Eisenman has a thesis about, or he proposes Stephen's stoning an axe as kind of a secret cover-up, if you will, of James. Yeah, what do you think
I don't want to, you know, I don't want to take a position on the way characters get represented again and so forth because it's too convoluted an argument. But I do think he has shown these parallels and themes that didn't just come out of nowhere. So was there like not a historical Stephen, but it's really talking about James. But we do have in the Clementines, the Pseudo-Clementines, and that's what he's talking about, especially the Syriac version that we now have, a reference to James about this time 7 years after the crucifixion, getting thrown down on steps and almost left for dead, but he recovers, and then he later dies in 63. So we have, you know, this is where he's developing it. And I certainly am open to those ideas that don't think you're reading Acts and you're getting like, oh, this is the straight historical. I call that the master narrative that's taken over the world. But that's why people are saying James who? Because they don't, because you're reading a guy that basically deep six James, and therefore, you know, you don't know much about James. So what do we know? Well, I'm pretty extravagant. I think Eisenman might agree with this. In fact, I think he might have, maybe he does say this. Yes, I'm pretty sure he does, thinking back. But I would agree with him. James is the beloved disciple in John, but very disguised now. But the one to whom Jesus puts his mother, or into whose care Jesus puts his mother. The Zebedee idea is crazy. He's a fisherman. There's nothing good ever said about Zebedee. I think he's rebuked twice by Jesus in the Gospels. One is when he wants the position on the right and left hand with his brother. And the other is he wants to burn a village that didn't accept them. And Jesus says, you don't even know what spirit you're of. So this image of the Zebedee. Now there's another John the Elder, that is this like love one another guy and so forth. And the could be, we think there might be two Johns. That's what Eusebius says, but that's another subject. Anyway, I think James is a beloved disciple. That would mean that he's at the Last Supper, and we have even at sources that put him at the Last Supper. He's very important. Eisenman says this, and I agree with him. If you want to understand the early Jesus movement, go to James the Just. And as he's going to give you the clue more than Paul is. I'm talking about before Paul.
Yeah.
And therefore, we didn't just lose a character like, oh, well, we don't know much about James. We've lost this whole ethos that he represents. And yes, a lot of it's reflected in the Dead Sea Scrolls. It's just a way of thinking about the redemption, about salvation, about the world, about the future. And it's not this dualistic Pauline cosmic thing. It's much more on earth as it is in heaven. The earth is important. The earth is the place to be. So he's important. The letter, look, everybody says it's good Hellenistic Greek. A semi-illiterate or even literate person like James, a Jew from the first century, couldn't have written it. But when you read the themes of James, I find it quite striking that he only refers to Jesus twice. And if you take those references out, the sentences read perfectly well. Like, hold not the faith in vain. If a poor man comes into your assembly, says, hold not the faith of our Lord Jesus in vain. Well, that's the faith of the prophets. That's the faith of the Torah. That's, you know, and then he mentions him in verse 1. And the rest, he does it, never even mentions Jesus. Nothing about the blood of Jesus, nothing about the cross of Jesus. No Pauline themes whatsoever. And whether he's addressing Paul or not about the faith and works, he's trying to say two things. That forgiveness is given by God all the way through the Bible. You know, that didn't start with Jesus. Jesus even said that with the two men who went up to pray in the temple. The humble one who repented went up justified. He's not a Christian. You know, you turn to God in prayer. Read Psalm 51, David's prayer. It's nothing about Christianity. You turn to your Creator, repent with all your heart. That's the piety of James. And have you noticed that a lot of the ethics are right out of the Sermon on the Mount, or Q, as I, you know, the Q source? Like, swear not at all, and don't do this, and don't do that. And so I think it's probably our closest reflection. It is apocalyptic. The judge stands at the door. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
And the judgment's coming. But notice it's going to be on people that are not paying wages to their workers. You see, it has kind of a different...
Political,
earthly. Social, yeah, earthly thing. So I love the book. I think it might be our last chance to glimpse maybe some kind of way of thinking that survived from the James movement. But I can't prove that James, the historical James wrote it. I love the way he addresses the 12 tribes, though, because he apparently feels that if the 12 are going to sit on 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel, then who's going to be the main guy in the middle? You say, well, that would be Jesus on earth. Who's the representative of Jesus on earth? Seems like he's saying, I'm James. I'm writing to the 12 tribes. Mm. See? So.
Now, real quick, the 12 tribes, because we only got like 1 minute, 2 minutes. How do you define that? Because there's different people who define that differently. But do you think that's the Jewish diaspora, that the 12 tribes he's writing to?
Or I guess broader. He probably has
the same like a new constituted.
Just, he's well aware of the prophets. They've been scattered among the nations. And he probably believes, like Paul, they're coming back through the, now that the Messiah's here, he's, Isaiah 11, you mentioned it. He's going to regather the tribes, and he's going to gather the nations too. He's going to be assigned to the nations to bring righteousness. The nations are a part of it. You can't leave them out. But you have to have all Israel saved first.
Right.
Now, whether James would use that exact language like Paul, I'm not sure. But he's got some idea. Mm-hmm. You can't read the prophets without thinking that God has to reconstitute Israel, even if Israel's broader or defined more broadly, maybe not so ethnically. Because even the Jews, after all these years back then, you know, it's not like everybody could show. Plus, look at all the foreigners that married into the in the Hebrew Bible. Yeah. Joseph married an Egyptian. Moses married a Ethiopian at one point, a Cushite. And
that was okay, unless you go to Ezra, but that's under a specific political situation that
right.
You don't paint that everywhere. But there's some people who do that. Thank you so much.
Okay. I hope that helped.